It's really a pleasure to be here in Florence and to restart everything live. We were just saying virtual is good, but we want live as well. And I also welcome people who are virtual, and I hope they will enjoy this session. So, the session will be on the role of oocyte quality and sperm quality on the fertility potential. I mean, how good can we make fertility and pregnancy? And in fact, we will start with our first speaker, will be Professor Alessandro Genesani, and his talk is Carnitines and Antioxidants in PCOS and Perimenopause. Alessandro.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all to be here. So the topic today is carnitines and antioxidant. I have a little bit added three letters in the title, which is FHA, which means functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. Since the target here is probably a better understanding of how reproduction is correlated to nutrients and to food. So we had in the previous title a missing aspect that it's a relevant component just to better understand the story. So the starting is these carnitines. Carnitines are compounds which are naturally present in our biology. We can improve the content of carnitines just giving carnitines, but we have carnitines if we eat meat, red meat, the cow. Wonderful. We have the Fiorentina here in Florence, so you can't miss this. You need to have red meat. And carnitine is coming from the degradation of lysine, which is one of the most important amino acids contained in the red meat. And why I'm talking about this? Because carnitines are fundamental in the maintenance, the use of fatty acids inside the mitochondria to produce energy, and in general to maintain the strategy of the biology of a lot of cells. And carnitines, such as acetyl carnitine, are important just to counteract a lot of diseases, mainly due to aging, and they are affecting in a positive way a lot of activity inside tissues, but mainly inside the neuronal system. But probably I'm getting old, and the fact is related to the attention that I'm giving to the physiology of the evolution on mankind. Well, everything started at the beginning when the mankind was not able to find food unless probably collecting something in the ground. And the brain was of these size in terms of volumes. Then he started learning to hunt animals, and the brain arrived at these size. It started to reduce in the amount of the number of cells and in the volume as soon as agriculture started to be used. So this, for me, is essential. Meat is needed. We need meat, absolutely, in the right amount. Because we are predators. We are hypercarnivorous apex predators. I'm not saying this. This is the anthropological studies that is saying this. And our biology now, today, is not different from 50, 70,000 years ago. So this is the basis, because from the degradation of proteins, we have two groups of amino acids, those who are ketogenic and those who are glucogenic. You take glucose from these amino acids, you take ketones from these. These are to sustain the neuronal system. These are to sustain all other tissues. So we do not need glucose. We are able to have our own production of glucose. In fact, we have one animal in the African savanna, the leopard. He's the fastest animal. He's the fastest mammifer. But he is producing a lot of glucose, but he doesn't eat ice creams, cakes, and no sugar in the coffee. So where is coming from glucose? From proteins. Gazellas and other animals are giving the right proteins just to have glucose. So this man, Mr. Feuerbach, he is a master for me. Man is exactly what he eats. Well, this was a philosopher. He was thinking to the story of the mankind, to their cognition, but it's the same for metabolism. We are just what we eat. Good things, we are in shape and good health. Bad things, we have sickness. So let's starting to understand everything. This is the system that makes ovary production and obviously is permitting to the mankind to go on. We have moved from such kind of pyramid of our metabolism to this other one, where meat and beans and other relevant important things are really reduced in the right amount. So the evolution up to now we have seen in the percentage of overweight, obesity, is this one, which is not really good, obviously. And in the same time, the evolution of mankind in the last, let's say, 40,000 years has been this one. We have improved our surviving, but due to the mankind, but not to the changes of the biology. So we have started to cure more diseases, and we have learned how to head to get food. But the main target is to overcome the stress, and stress is something which is that the ability to cope, to accommodate, to adverse environmental conditions. The acute or chronic stress are the same? No. Is the bad one is the chronic. The chronic is hitting each of us every day, especially women. And this is at the basis of a hypothalamic amenorrhea. So the story is that hypothalamic amenorrhea has no organic disease, but just stressors, hitting on psychological, physical, or metabolic stressor. Probably you do not eat enough, you consume too much stress, reducing the amount of food available for other organs because you use too much the muscles. So the combination of these acts on the brain, mainly on the hypothalamus. You have the reduction of GnRH and you do not have enough gonadotropins. Everything is acting on neuroendocrine controls. So you do not have to think that everything is happening because LH is going down. You affect also other glands. Here you now have the, summarize of the panel for functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. So it's a very spread out disease all over the other endocrine functions. And cortisol is the main aspect that we have to check when we have hypercortisolemia in the upper level of normality in these patients, since all the other kinds of amenorrheas have no elevated cortisol. So we have some triggers. And carnitines, where they play their act? Here, in the transportation of fat acids inside the mitochondria, just to improve the Krebs cycle to produce energy. And we have used such kind of strategy, giving carnitines, and these are nice patients treated for functional hypothalamic amenorrhea from these levels of LH after 3-4 months. This is an historical paper, probably the first one published for this kind of diseases. And within 4 months, we got such kind of regular elevation of gonadotropins. No changes in the lifestyle in these patients. Later in the years, almost 20 years later, we demonstrated that the positive effect of carnitines is inside the hypothalamus. It counteracts the opioidergic negative action on the gonadotropin release, since we gain again the response of LH to naloxone test, which is the antagonist of the opioid receptors, which are masked for a certain kind of neuroendocrine controls by carnitines. So everything now has been really interesting, since carnitines are able to induce the oxidative stress of the oxidative use of glucose. So why not to add to carnitines some other substances that are able to affect or improve the antioxidative situation, which is highly represented in hypothalamic amenorrhea? Well, we treated these patients with carnitines plus N-acetylcysteine and L-arginine, and all this group of patients, they are in hypothalamic amenorrhea, got the results, but mainly those who were very severely sicked by the stress, those who are with level of LH very low. And we got the improvement of the LH, the reduction of cortisol, a little bit improvement of BMI, but mainly, you know very well, the reduction of amylase. Amylase is an indicator of the metabolic impairment, which is typical in these patients. Well, this gives clear idea that probably we have been improved the metabolic pathways. But what about reproduction? This is the response of LH before the treatment, and this is the response after the treatment to GnRH. We have improved greatly the response to GnRH because we have improved inside the pituitary cells the amount of LH available, produced, just ready to be stimulated. which is lacking here. No changes when the patients, though with amenorrhea, have normal level of LH. So this represents absolutely a target important to, modulate in a positive way the metabolic compounds active on the neuroendocrine controls. More recently, we have just tested not really the dynamic response, but the baseline level of hormones, and we have targeted the ratios between some of these hormones just to see if we were able to counteract the excessive relationship between cortisol and androstenedione, as well as of other hormones that you know very well, and we see that all such kind of abnormalities were disappeared here. And we were interestingly related with LH, which is now positively correlated to free T3, which means that we have improved LH and we have improved also the available hormone from thyroid, which is the main leader of metabolism in these patients. So the starting of the story is that carnitines are able to act through not only direct action of carnitines on the metabolic pathways passing through the mitochondria with the beta oxidation, but also through the presence of substances such as N-cysteine and arginine, since they are working towards to counteract the oxidation. And the oxidation, we know very well, is highly active in these patients. And the reactive oxygen substances are those in charge of a negative effect on secretion of BDNF and also on impairment on cognition. And this is happening not only in young people, but also in older people. And the activity of NEC as L-arginine is to modulate the antioxidative effects of all the stressors so that you reduce the oxidative stress, which is here, the one impairing the BDNF and also a lot of the synaptic plasticity, typical of these patients. But the model is completely ongoing. If you heard my lecture a couple of hours ago about metabolism, I have been working also to understand how also in PCOS metabolism is relevant and important. So the question was in our group, but what about such kind of treatment, the combination of antioxidant and carnitines in polycystic ovary disease, which is completely different, obviously, from hypothalamic amenorrhea? Well, the data that we have said that carnitines are able to reduce the insulin resistance. And this is a meta-analysis that say this. So carnitines are important in PCOS, especially if you have insulin resistance. But similarly to this, so not only carnitines, we have the data on the use of N-acetylcysteine and also L-arginine. So these are putative compounds useful also for PCOS. So we made a study to see if the combination of carnitines together with arginine might have the theoretical approach, positive approach, to reduce the oxidative stress, since this is the trigger of all this kind of cascade inside the cell, because this is the promoted transcription of pro-inflammatory cytokines that activates insulin resistance. And this is something that is clearly known happening in PCOS. Well, we studied a group, which is not so small, 45 patients, overweight, for 6 months in a row, treated with this combination of L-acetylcarnitine, carnitine, arginine, and N-acetylcysteine. And look here, these patients in the baseline conditions have little by little the decay, the degradation of insulin, with changes also in the cholesterol and HDL, and the OMA index is going down. So this means that we were acting on both all the system, improving the metabolic impairment that is typical in these patients. And we are acting on the metabolic aspects of this. But the most interesting thing is this one. We have checked those that had insulin above 12. You see, if you remember the lecture of this afternoon before, above 12 microunits per milliliter, we say that these patients are at risk of having a real insulin resistance. Well, the great amount of these patients were 39 with such kind of situations. Only 6 were, let's say, normal insulinemic. No changes during the treatment, but this situation is exactly the opposite here, where this patient has have the decay of all these parameters that are significantly different from these patients, but become in the same range after 6 months of treatment. So this means that we have improved the real PCOS that had real problems in terms of metabolism and in terms of effective control of the good environment, leading probably an impairment on the, also the effects of insulin on kisspeptin neurons driving GnRH. And this is the oral glucose tolerance test. You see, baseline, 3 months, 6 months. This is the curve of insulin. So if someone is going and performing the whole sets of 4 hours of sampling, but if you just do the 1 hour test, so baseline, you drink the glucose, and then you have at 60 minutes the sampling, this is the going down of insulin. So we have a dramatic reduction of the hyper-responsive insulinemia that was present here. And in our lab, in our department, when the insulin response is around 50-55 microunits per milliliter, is a normal response. So we have restored the normality of the response in these patients. But we have done something in addition, which is we are trying to understand what was going on and what might be the reason for such kind of reduction in these patients. Well, we know a little bit of the insulin story. Insulin is cleaved from proinsulin. You got two molecules. From the pancreas, the two molecules through the vessels reach liver, where we have the clearing of insulin, at least 50% at each passage, but no changes, great changes in C-peptide. So the ratio between insulin and C-peptide is 1 here and 0.5 here, theoretically. So this means that the circulating of insulin and C-peptide in the plasma reflects not only the production rate inside, obviously, the pancreas, but also the clearance exerted by the liver every time that the blood is passing through. So we decided to better understand such secretion, and I discovered, since it has been a very long time that I have studied physiology, that insulin is secreted in a bimodal way, a fast release, where with the oral glucose test you have the immediate release of a great amount of insulin already prepared and stored, and a slow release, which is increasing little by little together with the C-peptide. If we perform the ratio between insulin and C-peptide, this is before the drinking, this is after the first response, the fast release of insulin, then you have the going down due to the exhaustive activity of the fast release, the going down, and the slow release means that the pancreas is releasing insulin and C-peptide together, so the ratio is more or less stable. So we were deciding to get the analysis of the hepatic insulin extraction considering the whole set of points of the oral glucose test. So we made just the area below the curve, just to understand. And you see here, we have the incredible reduction within the 6th month of the HEE index, which means that we have reduced and improved the insulin resistance due to the fact that we have eliminated a higher amount of insulin through the passage inside the liver. So this is really important. This means that probably the antioxidant action that we have played have improved something inside the hepatocytes. Don't ask me what, but probably the antioxidant process that we have performed have improved the ability of the hepatocyte to perform in normal ways the activity through a better expression of the insulin degrading enzyme. In PCOS, we have an impairment here, since the oxidative stress reduces such kind of expression of substances, reducing nitric oxide, reducing the formation of the thiols compounds, and mainly the activation of the nitrosoglutathione molecule, which is the most important and relevant antioxidant in our body. And this is relevant to affect through this passage, if not properly done, improving the blood pressure and impairing greatly the oocyte development. That's why we might improve the fertility in these patients. We reestablish inside the cells an optimal performance in terms of metabolism and antioxidant effect. And this is the strategies. Arginine, cysteine, we re-improve this, we block the effect of oxidative stress, we re-improve here the glutathione synthesis, and we improve everything, which means the restoration of the normality. So the standard of the action is probably to better perform the metabolic strategies in these patients, the antioxidative performance. But women are not just young. They might get, older, might reach the fertile moment of their life, but they might do little better or maybe little worse when getting close to perimenopausal moment. And we know that perimenopause and later menopause have a lot of changes in terms of biology. And we know very well that a part of these that we know very well, which are due to the blunt of general steroids coming from the ovaries, we have a biological increase of insulin resistance. It has been already demonstrated that this is to protect the women from not having enough food to survive, not nowadays. 10,000, 50,000 years ago. The insulin resistance is a killer in women. It's at the basis, obviously, of the cardiovascular disease. And the problem is that we know very well that we have the deposition of fat in the wrong places, which are more insulin resistant. And the fact that insulin sensitivity is going down is correlated to the increase of systolic blood pressure, so the risk of cardiovascular disease. So, oops, it's not going on. Can you help me? Thank you. So we have this cartoon that the growing up of the insulin resistance or the going down of the insulin sensitivity is something which is biologically and naturally occurring. So the real problem is who are at risk of this? All the women? Well, probably most of the women, but for sure, the insulinemic response is higher, especially in those that had the history of PCOS. So those that had an impaired probably metabolism even when they were younger, infertile life. Since the problem of the insulin resistance is something which is problem-ing a built-in defect, so we might study better these patients with a predisposition or not to diabetes, and we should know this just to avoid eventual future problems in these patients. So we treated a group, a pivotal study, 15 patients for 3 months before and after the administration of this combination of N-cysteine, L-arginine, and the 2-carnitines. And we tested, and I wanted to show this data, both C-peptide, no difference before and after the treatment, but look at the insulin. These are perimenopausal women in the average between 46 and 48. Look at the insulin. More than 100, above 45, normal. And this is just an effect related to antioxidant compounds and a little bit of carnitines. And what about the hepatic insulin extraction? Well, since C-peptide is not changing, we are not affecting, and in this it is not changed, the pancreas production rate of insulin. We have incredibly reduced the changes of the blood concentration of insulin since we have re-improved the degradation of insulin. So something is occurring not really in the periphery, but mainly in the liver. And the hepatic insulin extraction index, check here, is going down. This is after the 3 months of treatment. This is the area of the curve. The number of patients is 15, so very easy, very low. But these are the real expected good things working on the antioxidant effects. So again, such kind of model is coming out. So the insulin resistance is probably positively modulated and affected and so reduced by the use of this such kind of combination. And the model is here, again, the same that we have seen for PCOS. We have improved all the control so that to get the better results in production of glutathione or reactivation of glutathione. So the conclusion is this, that we might efficiently work just with compounds that are able to modulate the antioxidant effect and through carnitines also the metabolic pathways, improving inside the cell the production of energy through the lipid acids. But the carnitines are important not only because we give them, but also if we eat them through the red meat. So we might work in a certain way on three different situations. The stress due to functional epithalamic amenorrhea that affects neuroendocrine production, the impaired metabolism of PCOS, and also the biologically, classically occurring these metabolic changes during the menopausal transition. But pay attention. Most of these patients are worsening with the age due to the fact that they had been PCOS at the very beginning. Thank you very much.
Thank you again, Alessandro. That was really interesting. It's for sure we are what we eat, but what we eat determines our metabolism. Okay. So I will leave the questions to the audience for Alessandro. Anybody has some?
Can I have a question? You know, the changes in body structure are typical of the menopausal transition, and the increase of visceral fat is also a characteristic of the women at that time, where we have also changes in insulin resistance. Then, do you believe one part of your data, they were in polycystic ovary, postmenopausal, who had a family history of diabetes in family. And the fact that in those who have normal insulin concentration, you don't observe any significant change, this is strongly supportive for the idea that to have a family history of diabetes is also included also to have fragility in the system of insulin sensitivity. And do you believe that liver hepatic extraction is that one associated with any other changes in the liver function who can be supportive of the concept that a family history of diabetes and so on is can influence hepatic extraction? But this indicates that the liver, not only for insulin, but the liver have something different than the other patient.
Yes, it's a completely complicated model. The idea, this is probably the top of the iceberg. I really do not know what is happening inside the liver in a very peculiar way. But the interesting thing is this. What's the common parameter between PCOS patients, so young and fertile or subfertile, and menopausal women? The abdominal accumulation of fat. So the target in both situations is that at 30, 25, they have abdomen filled with fat. At 50, 55, they have the abdomen filled with fat. So the situation is that they have a greater amount of fat, which is insulin insensible in both cases. So that's why the perimenopausal women were worse than those who had no history of PCOS. The second aspect is that the liver is something that we have more or less ignored for years. We have not been taking care of it. But we know very well that one of the main aspects in case of menopausal transition for obesity is that we have steatosis of the liver in most of our overweight or obese premenopausal patients. So the idea is this. We might try to understand what's the history of the patients. And whenever we are able, if we have the chance to get informations in the women of the previous years, also infertile life, we can clearly have informations. And above all, if they have the familial predisposition to diabetes. Because this creates, for sure, and I talked this 2 hours ago in the previous meeting, that we have the predisposition inside the liver, not only for the problems in periphery for the epimerase, which is related to inositol story, but to a lack of the insulin degrading enzyme, which is toxically blocked by the presence of excess of oxidative environment. So the real problem here is that whatever we have doing and eating and moving, which is able to produce also through the neuro-induced stress for the everyday life, we improve the ROS, the reactive oxygen substances. And all this is acting bad on the brain, on the hypothalamus, and if you are going on with the ears, also on the liver, starting to work on the liver when you are 25 with PCOS and insulin resistance. So the real problem is that Feuerbach was really, really a genius. We have to take care of our nutrients in feeding. We have to take away our life from the stress. Probably we might find solution for having an easy life, or at least to be less stressed, to reduce the reactive oxygen substances. Or we might protect us taking something which is able to refill the activity of the antioxidants, endogenous antioxidants, so that to protect mainly the liver, since steatosis and liver fibrosis are typical with the menopause, mainly with PCOS, and really bad in PCOS, that in menopause might have a greater risk of diabetes. So it's a complicated story, but we are gynecologists. We should take care of the women, since we are the only ones that will visit the women.
But I think it's also a men problem.
Take care.
It's also a men problem. I thank you, Alessandro, very much. It's my pleasure that beautiful the presentation and also the discussion.